I speak to you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen. You may be seated. It was a warm fall day, and a young father with his 3 or 2 year old son was sitting on English Bay playing in the sand. And as they were playing in the sand, they were watching the sun begin to enter the horizon. And as the sun entered the horizon, they stopped. And the little boy was mesmerized because when the sun gets close to the horizon, you can see it moving. And he was in absolute awe. And they sat in silence, holding hands, watching the sunset into the horizon. And when the sun had disappeared, the little boy looked at his dad and said, "Daddy, do it again." And the father said, "I can't." The little boy began to cry. So the father decided he would wake the boy up the next morning early, before the sun rose. Took him up to Burnaby Mountain, and they sat there in the near dark waiting, and all of a sudden the sun began to come up over the horizon. And again they were mesmerized, and they sat in silence as the little boy watched the sunrise. And he looked at his dad and he said, "Daddy, you did it again!" And he began to laugh. This is radical amazement. And it's what I want to talk about today. Radical amazement compared to what I'm going to call scrupulosity. Radical amazement can bring tears and it can bring laughter. It can bring a sense of awe, amazement. Let me ask you as a child. What were you doing when you were called for dinner and you came home late and were amazed that the day had already passed? My childhood was filled with imagination and color and wonder. A bug, a piece of dirt, a rock, pets, birds, creeks. Everything around me held an invitation towards amazement. Somewhere along the line, I began to lose that. How does that happen? In our Old Testament and Gospel passages, both Abraham and the Pharisees have lost any sense of radical amazement. Both are preoccupied with agendas. Both are displaying varying degrees of scrupulosity within themselves about God and about others. Scrupulosity. It's a form of compulsion that involves religious or moral preoccupation. Scrupulous individuals, or when we act scrupulously, are often overly concerned that they thought or did something wrong, or that they might sin against some moral doctrine. And often they also act as moral police for your choices, trying to catch you in a sin. And this can actually be a form of false pride that says that I'm better than you are. It seeks to make everything predictable, controllable, measurable, and it's reduced to a right or a wrong. And when we tend to take everything this way, we tend to begin to take things for granted, or we think we are entitled. For the Pharisees in our passage, this scrupulosity is used to justify their plans to kill Jesus. They've been plotting since chapter 12 of Matthew. And in this story, their plot to entrap him and make his death palatable to the masses and to the Roman overlords backfires on them. They do succeed eventually. They start by justifying their actions, or they start by this feigned flattery. "We know you're a sincere guy. You teach the way of God. You're a truth teller. You're impartial. You don't pick sides." And then this simple, quick question. "Tell us, is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not?" Now Jesus sees their ploy and he calls their bluff and literally calls them hypocrites. Something else is going on here. Like us, the Jewish people did not like paying taxes to Rome. The Pharisees, they sort of mildly spoke against this tax, but they willingly paid for it and often benefited from their relationship with the Romans. The Herodians, who in the time when Matthew was written weren't even around, they were followers of Herod, so to speak. They were a group that overtly supported the Roman government and their tax. However, that's not all. The tax spoken of here was a very particular tax. It wasn't general tax. It was a census tax, a head tax. And it had to be paid in Roman coins, in cash. A coin which the Jews found idolatrous. It contained an idolatrous image of Caesar with the blasphemous inscription, Tiberius Caesar, August son of the divine August, high priest. And hence the trap for Jesus. If he supported the payment of the tax, he was condoning idolatry, and the masses would turn against him. If he didn't support the tax, it meant the Pharisees could justify an arrest by the Romans, and they would execute him like that. And the Pharisees would look like these keepers of the Jewish tradition and values. And so Jesus said, "Show me the coin." And they sheepishly produce one of these idolatrous coins. Interesting that the Pharisees, perhaps in the temple, possess one of these idolatrous coins. Already their hypocrisy is somewhat exposed. Whose head is on this coin? Whose title? Well, the emperor's. And Jesus said, "Well, then that's easy. Give to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's." And the Pharisees, like us, are silenced, and they depart in shock. And as we know, they'll be back. I want to suggest that this is not about paying taxes, nor is it about separation of church and state, as tempting as that might be, but that this is about radical amazement and awareness of all that is God's. This is radical amazement and gratitude for all that God has given. In the light of this, everything else pales. The question isn't, what are you giving to Caesar? The question is, what are you giving to God? This is a much more significant question than just paying or not paying taxes. In our Old Testament passage, Moses is tempted by a similar limitation. In the journey out of Egypt, he has seen some amazing things, and yet the urgency of the current situation threatens to overwhelm him. I get that. Happens to you too. I look back over the panorama of my life, and I see the presence of the divine, even in the things I found difficult. But I live in the urgency of now, of the present, and God doesn't always cooperate or make his purposes clear. I know them in principle, but not in practice. And so Moses asks, as we do, "Where are you? You made some promises to us. You said we were special. You said these crazy people I'm meeting were special and would be led to a promised land filled with milk and flowing honey. And here we are, stuck in the desert." Egypt doesn't look so bad now. And Moses is saying, "I need some reassurance. I'm feeling alone in all of this. Besides, Aaron, my sidekick, has just disappointed me with that golden calf stuff. It feels like you've abandoned us too. So give me something. Show me your face. Look me in the eye and tell me you're there for me. Show me your glory, your essence." Now Moses has had a similar conversation with God before. When he felt called to lead the Israelites out of Egypt and confront the Pharaoh, he asked God, "Well, who should I say you are? What is your name?" And God said, "I am." "What do you mean, you am? You am what?" "I just am. I am who I am. Tell them I am sent you. Try that." Too vague for Moses, perhaps too vague for us. "You are what?" "No, just I am." "Meaning?" "Just I am." It's as if God says, you decide what that means. Pure existence, pure being, light, love, not limited by the concrete, not a noun, not limited by being a person, a place, or a thing. I just am. A number of people reflect on this. Richard Rohr, Victor Hugo, Buckminster Fuller, Sarah McLachlan, John Shelby Spahn, and the Jewish rabbi David Cooper. And they suggest that perhaps we should begin to imagine God as a verb, not a noun. John Shelby Spahn, in a great quote, says, God is not a noun that demands to be defined. God is a verb that invites us to live, to love, and to be. Where does that take you in your imagination? For me, it's overwhelmingly wonderful and mysterious. Radical amazement, perhaps. And this, I believe, is the invitation of these passages. We like nouns. They're more specific. They're more controllable. They're more definable. A friend of mine says that if God is a noun, then he's an atheist. But then he says if God is a verb, then we have something to talk about, to ponder, to be amazed by. And that's the message of Jesus in this passage. And that's the message of God to Moses. Abraham wants God to be a noun as well. A controllable subject. Someone that's there for his bidding. An understandable and predictable commodity, sameness yesterday, today, and forever. Perhaps that is true, but not as a noun, a concrete reality, but as a verb, full of action, flow, life force, creativity, abundance, emerging, evolutionary action, goodness, truth, and beauty. The Pharisees want to keep God as a noun as well, a noun that they created, so that they can co-opt and manipulate God for their own agenda. And Jesus insists on the overwhelming action, flow, or life force of the divine, which pales in the light of silly or entrapment questions about taxes. Too much verb to comprehend. We tend to create subjects or objects, and in so doing, are tempted to make them idols. Richard Rohr suggests that we focus on what he calls the givens. He names the givens as the things that God has created. They're just given. The world, the universe, love, hope, joy, peace, all the gifts of the Spirit. We tend not to focus on the givens. We tend to focus on the things that we have created. And he says that we spend 90% of our time and energy focused on the things that we have created. And in this next generation, he says it's 98%. He calls it incestuous. Their whole preoccupation is with the things that we as humans have created. How to keep the ones we have, how to get more of them. And we forget that even those things we create are created out of the given. Here the call is to focus on the givens, the things that God has made, and the reality that God just is. Overwhelming? Yes, overwhelming. That's why Moses can't see God's face. That glory, that life, it's too much light, it's too much love, it's too much essence, too much reality, too much of a verb to comprehend. And all of us in our grammar lessons know that between the subject and the object is the verb. It dwells right in that space, in that eternity between subject and object. And so what does God do to Moses, and perhaps to us? The passage goes, and the Lord continued, see, there is a place by me where you shall stand on the rock. And while my glory passes by, I will put you in the cleft of the rock. And I will cover you with my hand until I have passed by. And then I will take away my hand, and You shall see my back, but my face shall not be seen. See my back as a little polite. Backside would be more accurate to the original Hebrew. Not easy to preach. My Old Testament professor suggested that God mooned Moses because God knew that if he could get Moses to laugh, Moses could see more of God and not be overwhelmed. Going too far? Perhaps. Perhaps not. But regardless, seeing this would be a radical amazement. Imagine, I'd be going, ugh. So that's my overriding invitation this morning. I want to say that or suggest that the best way to limit our understanding and experience of God and the importance of faith is to take things for granted. To become bogged down in things, thoughts, and ideas, in subjects and objects. Abraham Joshua Heschel, the great Jewish scholar and mystic, said near his death, "Never once in my life did I ask God for success, or wisdom, or power, or fame. I asked for wonder. I asked for wonder. And God gave it to me." He further suggests that as civilization advances, the sense of wonder declines. Humanity, he suggests, will not perish for want of information, but only for want of appreciation. And what we lack is not a will to believe, but a will to wonder, to be amazed. Andre Nallen suggests that we begin to notice the cracks or the flowers that come up in the cracks of the sidewalk. Won't make the sidewalk softer, but if you notice the flowers coming up in the cracks, you'll notice more of them, and more of them, and more of them. Heschel continues that our goal should be to live a life in radical amazement. Get up in the morning and look at the world in a way that takes nothing for granted. Everything is phenomenal. Everything is incredible. Never treat life casually. He suggests that to be spiritual is to be amazed, to see the ordinary miracles all around us and within us. Like the child in our introductory story, feel free to cry out when things don't turn out the way you hoped. But then stop. Then wait. Learn solitude. Make friends with silence. And then laugh when things come around again. Always praying, "Daddy, Mommy, do it again."